So this is experimental archaeology and investigating the life, death, and afterlife of wooden anthropomorphic figures in prehistoric Europe. So this is a team lecture by Aidan O'Sullivan, Brendan O'Neill, Ben Gearey, Caitríona Moore, Mark Griffiths, Michael Stanley, Orla Peach Power, Brian McDonnell, Billy McFlynn, Rob Sands, Hamish Dara, Conor McDermott, from a range of different institutions. But this is primarily a collaborative project between University College Dublin and University College Cork, as we shall see. So I'll be speaking about how we can use experimental archaeology to understand prehistoric wooden figurines in the past. So a reminder, this is the definition that we use here in Dublin of experimental archaeology. We see it as the reconstruction of past buildings, technologies, environmental contexts, and things based on archaeological evidence under use, testing, and recording as analogies to create a better understanding of people's lives in the past, and of course their relationships with buildings, things, and material culture. So we see experimental archaeology as something that investigates archaeological evidence in the present, using buildings, technological processes, cooking and food, and a range of different things, and to use them as analogies for understanding the archaeological record better, and thereby understanding people's lives in the past better. So there are numerous Bronze Age and Iron Age wooden figures from European wetlands, typically found in bogs. At least 40 figures are known. They range in type and in form and in chronology, and perhaps in terms of function. They don't necessarily have been all used for the same thing. They are generally interpreted as fertility gods or goddesses, or perhaps warriors or guardians or waymarkers, or perhaps some sense of community identification of place. They are often deposited, as we understand them, ritually in wetlands, in bogs and fens. And that seems to mimic, in some cases, the treatment of human remains. So here in this slide, you can see the Iron Age Roos Carr figures from England, the Brodenberg figure from Denmark with its phallus. And here on the right-hand side, a Bronze Age yew wood figure from the North Irish Midlands, dating to the somewhere in the Bronze Age. An increasing number of these wooden figures have been found in Irish bogs in the last 20 years, originally by the Irish Archaeological Wetland Unit, which surveyed a lot of bogs, investigating bogs before their milling and removal by Bord na Mona, the state agency for peat harvesting for the production of electricity. This project that I'm going to talk about today focuses on one specific figure from a raised bog in Kilbeg in County Offaly, right in the middle of the country, right in the Irish Midlands. And this was a figure which was found in an isolated location, but may well have been originally associated with the trackway, laying on the surface of the bog. As you can see, it'd been damaged there by machines, but when lifted, it became evident this was a very interesting figure indeed. So this figure was lifted, conserved, and is now in the stores of the National Museum of Ireland. It's a very distinctive figure. It's carved of alder-wood, first of all. And this is an interesting tree in itself, because when it's actually carved, the chemicals in the cambium, in the timber of the wood, go a very, very bright red colour. And alder is known as the red man in Irish folklore because of that. Alder is commonly used for making these anthropomorphic figures in Ireland, but not exclusively. Oak and yew and other species of wood are known as well. It's about 2.3 metres in length. So, you know, it's approaching the height of a person once it would be in the ground. It is clearly an anthropomorphic figure. It is a clear effort to represent a human form. The top of it, it has a bulbous, featureless head, as you can see there. There's no facial features as such, as has been found in other figures, but it is clearly a head. It widens then, using a slender neck, to sloping shoulders. The wood on which it is carved is naturally curved, which gives it a lovely feeling of movement. And it it also has these strange features carved in more or less the middle of the figure. These are notches which have been axed across the surface of the tree, which we would interpret as something like ribs. And of course, it's interesting to reflect on why these might be portraying ribs. Is this a depiction of an emaciated person, a starving person? You can also see down towards the base here, there is a notch which seems to be a navel. So again, a representation of the human form. Bark has been left on the lower base of the figure. And then the end has been deliberately pointed. These are not the tool marks, the felling marks from chopping down a tree. These are a deliberate attempt to make a pointed end. And as you've already seen in the previous slides, it was excavated lying horizontal in a raised bog, in a bog which had produced a range of other Bronze Age trackways. So the Bronze Age Kilbeg figure became a focus of a very interesting artistic project, which was led by our colleagues in the Department of Archaeology in University College Cork. This is a collaboration between artists and archaeologists towards the replication of these figures. And they've published a range of online blog posts. They've also been involved in some very other interesting projects as well, such as the recreation of a carved wooden vessel from the Iron Age. And most recently, they've been involved in making dugout canoes. So really, they're exploring woodcraft. In December 2016, they came to University College Dublin to our Centre for Experimental Archaeology and Material Culture. And we did a day's work, working collaboratively, making some of these figures, as we shall see in a moment. And that led us to realise that we could use this process of replication through experimental archaeology to get us to think about these figures in interesting ways. So first of all, how were these figures made? Very straightforward technological question. And what happened to them then? In archaeological terms, what was its object biography, its own story from birth to life to death? And can recreating that biography help us understand its role in that society and perhaps its symbolic meanings? So here's us in December 2016. This is Michael Stanley, who was the archaeologist who actually excavated and published the Kilbeg figure originally, with some of our students, Maggie, Ewan and Chertimir. All of us working for there for the day, and some of our Cork colleagues were there as well, making these figures. So this figure here will be the one I'll most likely focus on. It's the one which is most like the Kilbeg figure, which Michael actually made. Just to point out that these were all made using half the bronze axis, which of course we found to be very effective tools. So the Bronze Age alderwood figures have stood there for over 4 years. In all types of weather. Now, this is Ireland, so our weather is never extreme, but it did range from summer drought to winter snowstorms. And you can see them here on the evening that they were made, on the 16th of December 2016. We decided to erect them in the ground, very close to the public fence and the public gate coming into the Centre for Experimental Archaeology so that passersby could see them and enjoy them. And then we started to steadily record them over the following years. So here's, for example, is the figures a month later, and you can see they haven't really changed very much. They've still got that extraordinary red colour from the sapwood, and that lovely white colour, which is the natural colour of alder underneath the sapwood. They, as I said, have stood there for 4 years. This is the figures a year later in February 2018. As you can see, the colours have now changed from red and white to brown and beige, and cracks or shakes are starting to appear in the timber. And this is them 1.5 years later in July. This is a very, very hot summer. We had a drought in Ireland that year, weeks without rain. And record-breaking temperatures for the Irish weather, but really what we're talking about is like 26 to 30 degrees Celsius. And here they are 2 years later in January 2019, and you can see the colours have shifted now quite markedly from bright beige and brown to grey brown and faded brown. And here they are 4 years later, more or less recently in February 2021, Two of the figures here are standing, Kilbeg 1, which is most likely the original figure, and Kilbeg 2. And Kilbeg 3 has snapped at the base, so it actually broke off at the base, which has given you that hint of actually what's actually has been happening to these figures. So what has been happening to them over the years? Well, wood is organic. It weathers, it rots, and it changes across time. It dries out as it seasons. It loses moisture. The colors bleach out. Cracks appear in the surface. It also suffers fungal attack. Wood rot is a form of decay triggered by moisture or xylophagus or lignicolous fungi, all of which lead to the return of nutrients to the soil. And fungi invades if the wood is continually damp, which of course it is in an Irish context, and you get brown rot, you get white rot, you get soft rot, you get various sort of different types of rot. What do the Kilbeg figures look like today? This is the, on the left-hand side is here as they were made, and here as they, basically as they appear now in the Centre for Experimental Archaeology. And you can see the visual appearance is quite striking, the colour changes, the cracks in the head there, and the appearance of fungus, as you can actually see on the surface. So we lifted three of the figures and examined them very, very closely for damage to try and assess what has actually happened to them. Very, very significant amount of fungal attacks. It's brown rot and white rot and Daldinia concentrica. This is King Alfred's cakes here, this fungal growth here. And then very extensive honeycombing, which is also an outcome of fungal attack as well. And they've also been attacked by various different types of creatures, wood lice, which is a type of crustacean. There are 35 species native to Britain and Ireland, and there's at least 10 invasive species in Ireland, and other beetles attacking the surface of the wood as well. And earthworms and slugs and snails, you can see here, there's one particular type of snail called yellow cellar slug. Which is present on the wood. We're not really sure what impact that they've had on the surface of the wood, but it can't have been necessarily very good. So that's all very well. So that's what the figures look like today. But what did the original Bronze Age figures look like? The Kilbeg figure. So going back to look at that figure again from our experience. Well, the original figure was probably exposed for a time. Its wooden head has been weathered. Tool marks were faded, but there's no clear evidence for fungal attack. The figure's bodies and ribs, there's some evidence for moisture loss. You can see the beginning of shaking or cracking. But most strikingly, the pointed ends on the original Kilbeg figure are completely pristine. The tool mark striations are still visible. There's no fungal or insect damage. There's no honeycombing like that pointed one, like in our pints. There's no shaking. It's in perfect condition. Ours have essentially been destroyed from standing in dry land soils. The Kilbeg figure did not experience anything like that originally. So we can begin to reconstruct the object biography of the Bronze Age Kilbeg figure. It was made, it had a birth, it was carved with bronze axes from unseasoned alderwood, worked green. During its life, it did not stand in dryland soils for any significant time. It's unlikely it was kept inside a roundhouse. It was not an idol on display. It probably had a short life. It stood vertically in a fen, pool, or waterlogged peat bog for at least some time, but certainly not years, weathering slightly, but its point was always in waterlogged anaerobic conditions. At the time of its perceived death, it was lifted and placed horizontally in a bog. It was buried like human bog bodies and carved wooden vessels were buried. And then, of course, it was recovered thousands of years later by archaeologists. So final thoughts. What does this all mean? Well, in a sense, a very simple experimental archaeology project that gave us some insights into what the likely experience of the original figure had been. And of course, it's worth remembering that across the world, wooden figures like these, they're not meant to survive. They're actually meant to rot away, such as the wooden totem poles of the Haida and the Tlingit in the Pacific Northwest. They're not meant to be in museums. They're meant to fall back down into the ground. And everything has its time. So we know in experimental archaeology can help us think about the impact of time and past material culture. We can think about that in terms of houses or earthworks, such as the Overton Down project, or things. What we're going to do next with the with these figures is we're going to make more of them. We're going to put them into a range of different environmental settings, including wetland conditions, And what we will hope to be able to do as well is bring these original figures, sorry, bring these replica figures to the National Museum of Ireland and compare them with the original figures, hopefully making sure that none of the insects, bugs and fungal spores come with us. So there it is. It's one of those experimental archaeology projects that it started out really just to make one of these things and gradually became a story of its own. And like all things in experimental archaeology, it provokes new questions and new ways of thinking potentially about material culture in the past. Thank you very much.